The first setting we'll be taking a look at is anti-aliasing. Anti-aliasing makes the game look a lot better by smoothing out the jagged edges around different objects in the game. As you can see, while we have this set to none or disabled, we get a lot of shimmering around the different objects in the game. All those shimmering effects disappear once we turn TSAA on. While we have it on, the game looks a lot better, and we only lose around 5% performance at maximum. Therefore, I definitely recommend to leave TSAA on. I also tested this both in 4K, 1440p and 1080p, and the results were the same no matter what resolution I was testing it in. You need to have TSSA on to make the game look playable. The reason you're not seeing any performance difference in 1080p is because I was hitting the FPS cap of the game. Hello ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to my video. Today we're taking a look at Apex Legends, where we'll take a look at all the different settings, how to compare in terms of FPS and fidelity, and lastly I'll show my own optimized settings that I would recommend. If you have any suggestions for future games you would like for me to analyze, feel free to write them in the comments below. Before we go into the specific settings, I wanted to showcase the two extremes of all low and all ultra, to see both the performance and quality difference between the two. This is the footage currently running in the background. From the footage of all low and all ultra, there is a few points to take. Firstly, all ultra use double the VRAM of all low, which is quite a large difference. Secondly, my RAM usage barely changed between all low and all ultra, which shows that the settings you choose have no impact on your RAM usage, with maybe the exception of the actual resolution you're playing in. Lastly, the game automatically caps out at 300 FPS, so should anyone be lucky enough to sit with a 360Hz monitor and also a PC that can actually run the game at that, well, you're out of luck because it caps out at 300 FPS. As you can also see in the video, there's a 30% difference between all low and all ultra, so we have a lot of headroom we can work with. So let's get started. Next, we're taking a look at texture streaming budget. This budget determines how many of your textures are loaded into your VRAM. In this game, you have two kinds of textures. You have low res and you have high res. When you have this setting set to none, it's using low res. When you have it set to anything else, it's using high res. This is why you are seeing that weird performance difference between the different settings. As you can see, while we have it on none, while we have it on low res, we gained 5% performance more comparatively to any other setting. However, once we go up from none to very low, low, medium, high, very high, insane, any of those, we only lose 5% and we lose the same amount of performance no matter which of these settings we choose, because they're all using the same resolution of textures. They just have more of those textures loaded into the VRAM. The amount of VRAM that you are going to use in this game will change a lot depending on how many matches you've been playing back to back, because it does save some of the textures from the previous match. It also changes between the different maps you're playing. That can make it a bit difficult to give a clear recommendation and say, okay, if you have this amount of VRAM, you should use this setting. I also performed two tests, one in 4K and one in 1080p. In 4K, with everything set to the max, I was using roughly around just shy of 10GB of VRAM and just shy of 5GB of RAM. While with the same settings in 1080p, I was using just shy of 8GB of VRAM and 3.5GB of RAM. Therefore, my recommendations, which will appear on screen now, is this. If you're going to play on Insane, you need to have at least 8GB of VRAM for 1440p and below. If you want to do this in 4K, you need to have at least 10GB of VRAM. Even though we almost use 8GB in 1080p, you can also use 8GB for 1440p. Because one of the friends that I'm playing with in this game has 8GB of VRAM, and in 1440p he's playing everything on max without any issues whatsoever. So it is doable. The higher the setting you can use, the more VRAM you'll use, but the less pop-ins you should experience while playing the game. If we then move on to texture filtering, this setting improves the sharpness of the different ground textures in the game. This might be difficult to see in a small video format, so I definitely recommend to put your video in full screen right now. While testing this in 4K, I didn't notice any difference between bilinear and all the way up to anisotropic 16x, which I also wanted to demonstrate here where I have zoomed in 500%. As you can probably see, there's really no difference between the two, so if you're playing in 4K or anything similar, I definitely recommend to just leave this at bilinear. If we then move on to 1440p, we start to get a bit more of a difference between the different settings. However, after we hit anisotropic 4x, there doesn't seem to be any difference going all the way up to 16x. And again, I have zoomed into 500% between anisotropic 4x and anisotropic 16x to show that there really isn't any reason to go any higher than anisotropic 4x. And if we lastly take a look at 1080p, the result is actually the same as 1440p. After we hit anisotropic 4x, there's really no difference to go any higher because you're not gonna notice any difference whatsoever. So to sum it up, for 4K I recommend that you use bilinear, for 1440p and 1080p I recommend that you use anisotropic 4x. Ambient occlusion is a shadow setting that adds extra shadows, soft shadows to the game. Normally this is done around crevices and other parts of the game where two objects are intervening with another. In Apex Legends, however, the ambient occlusion doesn't seem to add that much in terms of shadows and more so just make the shadows darker. This can be quite difficult to showcase in the video. In my first example, we are looking at the stairway where you can see on the left side of the stairway, after we go from disabled to low, we get some extra shadows, but after low, it just gets a tiny bit darker, those shadows. The next example I have is of the grass to the right. As you can see, once we go from disabled to low, we add some extra shadows, but once we go from low to high, the story is the same. The shadow just gets slightly darker. And lastly, I have also tried to make an example where I just switch between the different settings in a loop, so you're able to see the difference more clearly, because it can be quite difficult to show. And all of this just goes to show that there's no reason to go any higher than low on ambient occlusion. You do lose around 6% performance going from disabled to low, but it does add some extra shadows that can make the game look a bit nicer. Next, we're taking a look at sun shadow coverage. Sun shadow coverage determines how many shadows will be rendered inside the game based off the sunlight. However, as you can see in my testing, it didn't seem that any more shadows was actually being rendered. More so, it seemed like that the shadows that were already rendered got more detailed and got darker, and generally just looked nicer. That is a bit weird why that's happening, since the game also has a setting called sun shadow detail, which is supposed to do exactly that, which we'll test right after. The difference in FPS is quite low, only around 1 to maybe 2% difference, or around 2 FPS difference. So I would probably recommend to leave this at high, because you don't lose that much FPS, it's very minimal. And I like, normally that might be a personal preference, but I like that my shadows and everything else is kept as sharp as possible to make it as easy for me to spot enemies. Now let's take a look at sun shadow detail. At a glimpse, sun shadow detail seems to do exactly the same as sun shadow coverage. However, with sun shadow detail, that was actually what I would expect to see, that there's a difference in the details of the shadows that is already rendered between low and high. With sun shadow detail, we also get a bit higher performance difference with around 3%, 3.5% difference between low and high. I'm not sure why coverage is also determining the detail of the shadows. That is very weird. I don't know why that's happening. I've tested it over several, both PC restarts and game restarts. I don't know why that is happening. But either way, I recommend that you sync these two settings up. So if you chose to have low in sun shadow coverage, you should also use low in sun shadow detail, because you're not going to get anything out of it if you don't. And if you chose to use high in sun shadow coverage, then you should also use high in sun shadow detail to ensure that you actually get that higher detail in the shadows. Like with sun shadow coverage, I will still recommend to use the high setting for sun shadow detail, because it is very nice to have those shadows look so much better for only 3% performance. However, if you do need the FPS, you could set both of these settings to low. Next up, we have yet another shadow setting, this time spot shadow detail. Spot shadow detail, according to the game, is supposed to control the shadows coming from light sources in the environment. So that could be the shadows coming from different light sources inside buildings. But as you can see in my first example here, I couldn't find any difference whatsoever between having it disabled and all the way up to very high. And the same goes for the performance as well. After some investigating on the internet, I figured out that spot shadows detail actually controls the shadows on your character while you're in the menu, as you can see right here. Which is not what the game says, but that's been a reoccurring thing for this video. As you can see here, it does make a huge difference in how detailed and whether your character actually do have any shadows while you're standing here. And since this only affects your performance while you're inside the menu, while you're in the lobby waiting for a game to start, you might as well just use very high. It does come with a hefty performance cost, but it's only in the menus. And you want your shiny new and very expensive skin to look the best, don't you? So I would definitely recommend to use very high here. Next up, we have volumetric lighting. Volumetric lighting enables sunbeams and other general light scattering effects from the sun inside the game. So this is most noticeable while you're either looking directly at the sun, like I'm doing in my example, or if you're maybe inside a house or a covered area where you can see there's a skylight or an opening of some sort in the ceiling, where you're now able to get sunbeams coming in from the sun, from the sunlight. If we look at the quality difference first, you can see that the sun does get a bit more bright while you have it enabled, and the light is scattering a bit from the sun instead of just being one globe shining. This does look a lot nicer. However, it can also be very distracting and kind of annoying when you're running around, because I know that you normally don't just look up into the sun, but you can always see it while you're running around, and that extra light can be irritating and make it more difficult for you to spot enemies if you're looking at the direction of the sun. That, plus that you also lose around 7-8% performance, then this is definitely something you will want to disable, and that's also my recommendation. Dynamic spot shadows controls whether lights in the environment can move. This I have tested by running around inside this building, because we have several light sources placed around this building, which should then move while we are running around. However, as we found out earlier with spot shadow detail, which is connected to this setting, dynamic spot shadows only appear in the menu. So therefore we have to go out into the menu instead. Also because, as you have probably also noticed, there's no difference whatsoever while we have it either disabled or enabled while I've been running around in circles. Once we get into the menu, we can definitely see a huge difference between having it enabled and disabled. The difference is basically the same as having spot shadow detail disabled or having it on very high. Like with spot shadow detail, I therefore also highly recommend to leave this enabled, because it's only going to affect the shadows in your menu, and like I said last time, you want those beautiful skins to look the best they can. Next up, we finally have a setting that's not a shadow setting. Now we're going to take a look at model detail. Model detail is a bit of a special setting because it affects certain objects and items in the game where the higher you choose this setting, the further away they will be loaded in. But since it only affects a certain amount of, I'm just gonna assume random, objects in the game, you won't always notice the difference between having it on low and having it on high. Here in the training area, I have found one example of that, where you can see between low and medium we don't really see any difference. But once we go up to high, we can suddenly see some extra detail on that metal stairway. Since this only affects a certain amount of random objects in the game where you'll get an extra amount of detail onto them further away, I recommend just turning this down to low, because I doubt that you're gonna really notice the difference, and it's always nice to gain those extra 3% of performance. Next up, we have effects detail. Effects detail controls how detailed visual effects, like for instance explosions, are in the game. I have tested this with multiple grenades to see if I could find any difference in terms of both FPS but also in terms of quality. As you can see, there's no difference between either of those two once I tested it between low and all the way up to high. I know this setting used to make a difference with the incendiary grenade, where you would actually be able to see a difference on the ground where it was thrown, but that does not seem to be the case anymore. I also tried out several other visual effects in the game, but I couldn't see any difference there either. And since we are within around 1% performance difference, I'll just recommend leaving this at high. Now let's take a look at impact marks. Impact marks determine whether or not a bullet will make an impact on the different objects in the game. So I have tested this by standing in front of a concrete wall where I'm shooting into the wall. So while we have it on disabled and low, you'll notice that there's no bullet marks appearing. However, on high, all of the bullets, or most of the bullets at least, are making bullet marks, enabling you to be able to see where the shots are being shot towards, but maybe also figure out where they're coming from. That is a huge competitive advantage to have, and something you need to have. That's why I already can say that I recommend leaving this at high. This is also because you're not losing any performance from it, so you might as well use it. Another important aspect is that the difference between low and high is the amount of different kinds of objects that bullet marks will appear on. So bullet marks will appear on anything when you have it on high, but it will only appear on a certain amount of items in the game when you have it on low. Therefore, I definitely recommend to leave this on high. And now we have the last setting of the video, which is Ragdoll. Ragdoll, contradicting to what the game actually says, does not control how physically accurate the body animations are of dead people. Instead, it controls for how long the bodies will stay on the floor before they despawn. As you can see here, while we have it on low, the bodies despawn after 1 second and 25 milliseconds, or something about that. While we have it on medium high, they despawn after the same amount of time, weirdly enough, at around 5 to around 6 seconds. In my testing, I only found at around 1% performance difference, and since that is very low, that could honestly be down to margin of error. I would recommend just leaving this at high. You could turn it down to low if you want the bodies to disappear quickly for some reason, but I would just recommend leaving it on high. Here are my own recommended settings, which are based off the recommendations I've made throughout the video. And here is the live showcase of my recommended settings put together. As you can see, the game still looks great and we're not experiencing any kinds of pop-ins or having trouble seeing items out in the distance. When I then stack this up against all low and all ultra, you can see that we have the same quality as all ultra, while getting around 17% performance compared to all ultra, which puts us perfectly in between the performance of all ultra and all low. But thank you all for watching. If you've made it this far and been able to use this video to get better FPS in Apex Legends, please like and subscribe for future videos where we'll take a look at other games. If you have any feedback on the videos or any other tips and tricks to get more FPS in Apex Legends, please share it all in the comments below. If you're interested in these kinds of videos, maybe check out the video made on Call of Duty Warzone or GTA 5. Have a nice day. Bye bye.